Macmillan Audio presents A Labyrinth of Scions and Sorcery by Curtis Craddock. Read for you by Erin Bennett. Chapter 1. Jean-Claude rubbed two copper pennies between his fingers. He was in the market for information, the collection of such being the greater part of his job. Unfortunately, the particular salesman with whom he was faced, a nervous tick of a man named Pacey, was a bit of a junk merchant, selling rusty secondhand rumors often cobbled together out of entirely different stories and missing critical pieces. "What scandal are you talking about?" Jean-Claude asked, having been pursuing this topic for some time. Pacey crouched at the mouth of his alley, looking around with the furtive air of a mouse who expected to be eaten by a cat at any moment. It would have to be a lower-class cat, probably a one-eyed stray with a yowl that could strip paint. "If I knew that, I'd be selling that," Pacey said peevishly. "All I know is that Mistwaith talked about auctioning off a scandal to get even with De Zephyr. Now where's my coin?" Jean-Claude, King's own musketeer, had been guardian to Princess Isabelle De Zephyr since the day she was born. She was his daughter in all but blood, and woe betide anyone who sought to harm her. "Getting even for what?" Jean-Claude asked. Isabelle was ambassadress to the Grand Peace. She'd spent the last year stitching together a treaty between L'Empire Celeste and the neighboring kingdom of Aragoth. This attempt to preemptively stop people from killing each other had naturally earned her many enemies amongst those who likened peace to weakness.
"How should I know?"
Pacey stared at the coins in Jean-Claude's hand. He bounced up and down like a nervous squirrel, his fingers twitching.
"He just said the Comte and his children would regret double-crossing him."
"Le Comte de Zephyr?" Jean-Claude asked, surprised.
Isabelle's father was a vile, twisted villain, but he was also dying of the red consumption hundreds of kilometers away on a remote skyland. What in all the 10,000 torments was a scandal of his doing here?
"Yes," Pacey whined. "Come on. I've told you all I know."
Jean-Claude tossed him the coins, which he managed to drop. Pacey spent the next several seconds chasing the coins around on the cobbles and panting in panic as if they were running away on purpose. He then counted his haul, both of them, several times before slinking into the alley. Jean-Claude couldn't care less about Isabelle's father. The sooner the man died, the better. But men seeking revenge frequently targeted the families of the ones they hated. Lord Brandon Mistwaith, golden tongue sorcerer and rumor monger of scurrilous reputation, must be dissuaded from taking any such action against Isabelle. Jean-Claude therefore exerted himself to obtain an invitation to the auction. The event was to be held this hour at an inn called the Golden Swain. Since showing up in a den of thieves and whisperers in uniform was likely to spoil the party, Jean-Claude had exchanged his blue and gold musketeer's tabard for merchant's garb, a floppy beret, a padded green doublet, and a pair of spectacles that he kept telling himself he didn't really need. At the appointed hour, Jean-Claude mounted up and rode to the low market. The main portion of the city rested on a narrow shelf of land between the deep sky and an immense cliff called the Riven Crag, which rose 2 kilometers straight up from the coastal apron. He passed beneath a wide stone archway, one of the many that cut through the buttresses the great cliff thrust out onto the plain, and emerged into the market circle. Here was a gladiatorial arena where great battles of commerce were daily enacted.
Hundreds of merchant stalls selling everything from flake bread to glimmer oil to dragonweed were staked out in mostly regular concentric rings around the open hub. More permanent structures were carved into the terraces that climbed the steep walls of the surrounding bowl. The market was as packed as a pickle barrel. Pedestrians only made progress by sliding and bumping, shuffling past each other like cards in the hand of a clumsy dealer. Merchants dickered with customers, whores flashed tempting bits of skin, and troubadours strove to be heard over the din of 1,000 voices. Beggars pleaded for alms, and gangs of urchins worked the crowd looking for purses to cut. A crowd had gathered around the stone platform in the center of the square to watch a troupe of dwarf acrobats perform. The Golden Swain was a large open-fronted inn near the livery stable on the far side of the market. A hanging sign depicted a gallant youth dressed in yellow dancing with a young woman in a blue dress. The back of Jean-Claude's mind kept busy trying to puzzle out just what scandal this Mistwaith person might be trying to sell. Le Comte de Zephyr had only left his Skyland once in all the years Jean-Claude had known him, and that was to attend his wife's funeral here in Rocher Royal. Isabelle had no interest in scandalous behavior, unless one counted being a female mathematician, a fact which she did not advertise. Perhaps Isabelle's brother, Guillaume, had committed some faux pas, like opening his mouth in the presence of functional adults. Jean-Claude's horse gingerly forded the human tumult toward the inn across the widest part of the square. Jean-Claude had chosen a long approach specifically to see if anyone took note of his arrival. It was always a good idea to know where the lookouts and toughs were perched. Jean-Claude had just passed by the dwarf-occupied platform when a man in fine clothes burst from the Golden Swain's back room into the open common area. His face was white, and his mouth gaped in terror. A piercing, inhuman scream followed him out the door and cut the noise of the market to ribbons. Several patrons in the Swain's common room lurched to their feet, upsetting the trestle tables and knocking their compatriots to the floor. From the open door lurched a horror. It had the shape of a man, if that man had been dipped head to heels in fresh spilt blood. He was a sanguinaire sorcerer in the midst of a horrible derangement of his powers. His whole body glistened crimson, and his scarlet shadow flailed about his feet like a maddened kraken. Carmine tendrils slithered across the floor, climbed the walls, and raced across the ceiling. One of them touched the fleeing man's shadow, and he toppled as if he'd tripped over a physical thing. The blood shadow pierced the man's ordinary umbra and spread through it like ink through water. The victim's spine twisted in spasms of agony. His body lost its crisp edges, slumped like a butter sculpture in the sun, and dissolved away until there was nothing left but a russet stain on the ground, a soul smudge that writhed of its own accord. The screaming, sobbing sanguinaire rampaged through the tavern, his blood shadow consuming patrons on every side. His ululating wail shattered into forsaken sobs. It was the sound of a soul being shredded on the breaker's wheel. Panic swept through the square. Frightened souls near the Golden Swain turned and ran headlong into people farther out. The terror boiled up into a stampede. People thundered across the market. The unlucky fell and were trampled. The dwarf acrobats abandoned the stage and bolted for their wagon. Merchants ducked into their shops. The human tide surged toward Jean-Claude. He raced after the dwarves toward their sturdily built, brightly painted carnival wagon. His mount plunged through the crowd as if through high water. A woman went down under his horse's hooves. The horse stumbled, righted itself, thrust forward. Jean-Claude dared not even look back. He skidded into the lee of the wagon as the mob broke around it. Wave after wave of bodies bashed against the timbers. People screamed, But above all the noise rose the sobbing, shrieking howl of the mad sanguinaire. In an instant of respite, Jean-Claude looked for a clear path to the monster. He was a king's own musketeer, versed in the means of disposing of sorcerers. He could not look himself in the mirror or Isabelle in the eye if he let this slaughter continue. An alchemical lantern hung on the cart's lamp hook. Jean-Claude deftly lifted it and lit it with his sparker. A clear flame jumped up, giving off a blue-white light. He clapped the front pane shut, then wheeled his mount. The low market was still emptying of people, but the greatest surge had passed him by, and many of those left behind were wounded stragglers. The sanguinaire had cleared out the inn and stumbled into the open. His blood shadow reached out long threads into the square, consuming the lame and unconscious. Outside the square, alarm bells called the city watch to arms. Jean-Claude drew his pistol. He had only one shot, and he'd need to be close. He kicked his horse to a gallop toward the sanguinaire. There was no point in subtlety. The man seemed lost in his own agony, gyrating like a drunkard with his horrible shadow flailing all around. Jean-Claude whirled the lantern on its short chain. There were only two absolute defenses against a blood shadow. One was total darkness. Blood shadows couldn't manifest without light. He hurled the lamp. Tendrils of blood shadow reached toward him. He tucked down and hung off the saddle, hiding his shadow in the horses. The lantern hit cobblestone. Glass shattered. Lumen vapor sprayed. The blood shadow grabbed the horse's shadow. The poor beast squealed and pitched forward. Jean-Claude launched from the saddle. His shadow touched the blood shadow, and his body wasn't his own anymore. He could not feel his flesh at all. Terror swelled in his chest. He'd misjudged his timing. There was a hissing whump and a white-hot flash as the hypervolatile lumen vapor ignited. An expanding ball of fire drove every shadow from the square. The other way to fight a blood shadow was with blinding light. Sensation returned to Jean-Claude's body just as he crashed to the cobbles. He tucked hard and rolled across his shoulders, narrowly avoiding being crushed by what was left of his horse. He heaved to his feet, spectacles askew. The sanguinaire, covering his eyes, blundered toward Jean-Claude. Already, the blood shadow reformed. Jean-Claude raised his pistol, aimed, squeezed the trigger. Fire and smoke. The gun kicked. The sanguinaire jerked. The blood shadow twitched and then dissolved as whatever mad mental faculty had been driving it retreated, and the sorcerer's whole attention focused on the hole in his chest. He was a ragged man, skin and bones and tattered clothes and no shoes. He fell over backward. His bare toes were bloodied with missing toenails. Jean-Claude took a step and nearly fell over again as his body reminded him that he'd just been shadow-burned and thrown from a charging horse. Every muscle that wasn't bruised was strained, and he'd bashed his game leg. Nevertheless, he stumbled onward, pushing his glasses back into place and drawing his rapier to finish the job. The sorcerer looked even worse close up. One of his eyes was white with blindness, as his flesh was pocked with running sores. His face was an effigy of poverty, thin and scabrous, with fewer teeth and gaps. There was nothing to him but papery skin and twisted bones. His forearms had been scarred by countless bleedings, and there was an open trepanning wound over his temple, his brain clearly visible within. Aside from the bullet hole in his chest, only the trepanning wound was fresh. He lay with his hands clasped over the wound in his chest. Blood bubbled between his fingers and his breathing gurgled like a downspout. Of his blood shadow there was no sign. His shadow was the same thin gray as any other man's, and that didn't make any sense. From all Jean-Claude had ever learned or witnessed, It was not until a sanguinaire's last breath had left his body that his shadow became normal.
"Who are you?" Jean-Claude asked, not expecting an answer.
The man's eye didn't focus, but his broken mouth spat out blood-flecked words.
"Gloom rises, brother. Harvest king. Look at the cracks. Voices in the dark have feathers. Tell the saints what to do." Their eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.